Governor, thank you very much for being here on our show. Again, it's a pleasure. And you are a very seasoned politician, so to speak, a typical great American politician. You have been in offices that a lot of people aspire for in this country. So let's just talk about a few things about your background. You were born in California,
right?
Whittier. That's where my three kids were born. Not exactly in Whittier, but close to Whittier, Torrance. Los Angeles, yeah. Los Angeles County. Basically, the purpose of this interview is to talk to you about your own political background and your aspirations and what you're going to be doing next.
Well, my political background actually started, believe it or not, in Orange County and in that area. In that my father became head coach of the Los Angeles Rams. In those days, the Rams were in Los Angeles, not St. Louis, although they may be moving back to LA. But at any rate, we moved out there from Illinois in 1966. Ronald Reagan got elected governor that year. And Ronald Reagan, as governor, would come to the LA Rams practices, the football practices. And so I grew up in a football family. And I thought, well, here's a politician who knows what's important, football, because he'd be studying the players. And you know, a lot of politicians, they go to the games, but they don't come to practices. So I followed what Ronald Reagan did as governor. And I thought, oh, I liked what he's doing. And then we moved to Virginia when my father came to be.
And that's where you also became, or you founded that club named after Governor Reagan back then, right, in California? Right, there was a small club at a school that you were heading.
No, not
maybe
then.
I got my history.
Yeah, yeah. No, I was. I didn't know I was going to get involved in politics. Mm-hmm. I majored in history. I wanted to be an architect, a lawyer, or a farmer. Mm-hmm. And so, summertimes, I would you had football, but then after undergraduate, I'd worked on ranches in Idaho and Nevada. Thinking I want to get into ranching, mm-hmm. But realized you need a lot of land, which takes a lot of money,
right.
And I didn't have it. Mm-hmm. So I ended up in law school. But while at the University of Virginia, I enjoyed debating and discussing issues with people, but didn't take any political science courses. Then Ronald Reagan decides he's going to run for president, mm-hmm. in 1976, and he asked me to be head of Young Virginians for Reagan. That's what you're thinking of.
Exactly. Okay.
And so I
so that wasn't actually Virginia.
That was in Virginia.
Virginia. Okay.
When I was at Mr. Jefferson's University of Virginia. And I remember talking to Governor Reagan. And I said, well, Governor Reagan, I know nothing about organized politics. He says, well, I understand that you go around, you have friends and you like me. I've said, oh gosh, yeah. I go around telling everyone how great you are and your ideas and how good they were for the people of California and how that'd be really helpful for the United States if you're president. And he said, well, just keep doing that. And so that's what got me involved.
That's his typical style. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so we won Virginia. He lost the nomination to Gerald Ford in 1976. But that's what got me involved in politics way back then in the 70s. And Ronald Reagan was my inspiration. And then the other inspiration, as far as philosophy, was Thomas Jefferson, the founder of the University of Virginia. And I still believe in that philosophy that he defined in his inaugural address, this is Thomas Jefferson, that the sum of good government is a wise and frugal government, which shall restrain men from injuring one another, but otherwise leave them free in their own pursuits of industry and improvement, that the government should not take from the mouths of labor the bread they have earned. And I think that's still the sum of good government today. And Ronald Reagan applied those principles. You had to have a strong national defense and unleash the entrepreneurial spirit of our country, of the people of America. And I do trust free people and free enterprise. And I think if the government does the things it's supposed to do. At the state level, the priorities are education and law enforcement. And at the national level, the top responsibility is national defense. And the way you pay for it all is with a strong economy, and you want to have competitively low taxes, reasonable regulations, utilize the blessings of our energy resources, and make sure that our young people are getting a good education. Because if you want to be the world capital of innovation, you need to have well-educated, well-trained young people to get the new inventions and innovations of the future. And so those were always my priorities.
Good. Governor, you've been involved in conservative politics for a long time, but have you felt changes in the approach and overall philosophical kind of scenario when it comes to conservatives? I mean, you were very close to President Reagan as a follower and also as a politician. But do you think President Reagan would have been happy with the current state of affairs with the Republican Party as well as the nature of conservatism that most conservatives follow now?
No, that's a really good question, because I'm the Reagan Ranch Presidential Scholar for the Young Americas Foundation. I think what was great about Ronald Reagan, and I think what he would be extolling us to do as Republicans, is put forward positive, constructive ideas. It is important to play tenacious defense and be against bad ideas. I think equally important, in fact, more important, is to say, all right, here is a solution. Here's an idea. It's based on our principles. It's proven this is how people will have more job opportunities when they graduate from college, or here's how our energy prices for gasoline or electricity can be less and make our country more competitive for manufacturing, for example. Ronald Reagan would have a very strong national defense. He'd want us to have the most technologically advanced armaments, and he would get others
to
join in.
Star Wars was one of his
ideas
that he
missile defense, and in fact, Israel is using a similar missile defense with their Iron Dome. And he thought the best way to keep the peace is through a strong national defense. So I think Ronald Reagan, everyone should remember what Ronald Reagan did, and is he ran on an agenda. He didn't run just saying, I don't like Jimmy Carter. People already had their views of President Carter.
At the same time, he was also a pragmatist politician.
Yeah, and in fact, Ronald Reagan got the tax cuts, the largest tax cuts, and that really got the economy going in the United States. The other thing was is he worked with the other side. So you had to get people in the other party to work with. And so that's one of the things right now is it seems like both sides are so dug in. And maybe you only agree on one out of five items. Well, do that one thing. Mm-hmm. Do that.
Get it out of the way and
move on. And then on the other four that you don't agree, that you disagree on, see if there's some place of common ground where you can find a consensus.
I mean, it's very binary thinking, either or, black and white.
So, well, there are certain things that may be black and white, and you should never abandon your principles. Or integrity. The one thing that is black and white is an integrity. And however, people are elected and they should keep their promises and stick to their principles and their philosophy. In the midst of it, recognize there's people who do not think exactly alike. That's just the nature of human beings. And another party has a different point of view. Find, though, where you can agree.
Governor, you served as a governor here in Virginia and also in the U.S. Senate as a Reaganite. What do you think is the current state of affairs internationally? I mean, Reagan was for small government but strong defense and, right, of course, international role. Do you think the America is now retracting from that concept? What's going on? Are you happy with the current status?
Well, I think the current status is fairly incoherent. It's hard to say what America's role is. I understand the American people are tired of war, and we lost a lot of lives in Iraq as well as Afghanistan. And so Americans don't necessarily want to be involved losing lives around the world, especially when you see when you do that, that some of the countries like Iraq did not take advantage of this opportunity. Other than the Kurds in the northern part of Iraq, all those factions came together and they said, we want a good society here. We'll put aside our differences for the benefit of all the Kurds. And so they've done well, and I do think it makes sense to support them. They want to fight themselves. To the extent that there's a conflict and battles and shooting, so to speak, the idea of Ronald Reagan of supporting those who want to fight for themselves makes sense. And in that case, the Peshmerga of the Kurds, they want to fight or protect their society, and I think arming them makes a great deal of sense.
So you support an independent Kurdistan, so to speak?
Well, I don't want to create controversy, but I think, well, they already have a lot of autonomy. And I do think they ought to be able to control their own destiny, and if the central government in Iraq is not able to protect them, they have to protect themselves. As I understand, the Kurds are the largest ethnic group that doesn't have their own country, and
but that, like, you know, involves two more countries.
That's the worry. That's why I don't want to cause it, because there's a lot of Kurdish people in Turkey
and Iran.
Iran's another sad situation.
Syria, as a matter of fact,
there's a little in Syria and Iran. Iran, the way I look at Iran, knowing so many friends from Iran, from Persia. That it's what a great civilization being ruined by a theocracy. They have so much potential, but it's being held back by a government. That's why, you know, here's Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan, when they had that uprising in Iran from the people, Ronald Reagan, he may not have started to, wouldn't have fired shots, but the people who wanted a more free and just society in Iran, Ronald Reagan would have made it very clear and plain, we're on the side of the people for greater freedom and opportunity for all. But our government was silent. They were mute during
what
that.
What went wrong in Iraq? I mean, you know, yes, invasion was, of course, you know, was carried out on some misinformation. The whole world knows about it. And some people still blame that decision because the country was invaded. And it was, you know, to an extent, much more stable than it is right now. So,
well, it's stable under a dictatorship, and a no-fly zone over the Kurds, so that they wouldn't kill more Kurdish people as Saddam Hussein had done. And Saddam Hussein was paying suicide bombers to bomb into Israel. So yes, it was more stable. You could say the Soviet Union was more stable as well under the communists. And you ask the question, what went wrong? Generally, if you go through life, if you live long enough, the words that you always say that are so true is, if I knew then what I know now. And we do know more now than we knew then. And people made the best judgments, and some were not necessarily correct judgments, or we didn't have the right intelligence and information on it. The thing for Iraq that's such a disappointment is that the people of Iraq had an opportunity to create their own government and not have all this divisions based on religion or ethnicity. And the other thing, mistake I think was made, is they didn't make oil a national resource. And so then they'd fight over where the oil is, who is this, Kurdish, is this Shiite, is Sunni. If they made it a national resource and every single Iraqi person could get a check, the way Alaska does it with their Alaska Permanent Fund, and every citizen of Alaska gets a check every year based on production, then the people of Iraq would say, this is a national asset. We're all getting $1,000 a year, $2,000 a year, whatever the amount is. And they'd care about the pipelines, and they'd be upset if somebody blew up a pipeline. That means money out of their pocket. At any rate, there are a lot of things that could have been done. Maybe they'll still get it right.
Governor, ISIS is covering large swath of Iraq now. Any ideas for dealing with them, with that horrible, the atrocities they're committing against the civilians? And so you have any ideas as a former U.S. senator? You've been on the Foreign Relations Committee, so you know much more about that area.
Yeah, well, this is obviously just a vile, hate-filled group. Completely intolerant of anyone who has any disagreement with them whatsoever. First and foremost, we need to support the Kurds in the Kurdish area. Getting that dam back was really important because water. Yeah, Mosul. That dam with those rivers and having been in that area, that's just absolutely essential for life and for agriculture, growing crops and so forth. Where I think the Kurds need to be armed, and I also think that there's other countries.
Armed by who? By the United States?
In fact, the French decided to supply arms to the Kurds before we did. And I do think we can give the training and logistical help, but they're also going to need to have the arms because ISIS has some armaments that that are U.S. that are left over from when we were there on the ground. So we're not dealing with just a band of guerrillas. These folks, ISIS, have some significant armaments. Now, the efforts we can make with drones and so forth make a great deal of sense. We need to use our unmanned aerial vehicles as much as possible for intelligence gathering as well as hitting their command and control. And the different levels that you'll want to hit, that's more of a matter of tactics, which shouldn't be stated publicly by anyone. I also think that other countries in the region ought to be involved. The Saudis supposedly care, you know, profess to care a lot of about this, as well as the United Arab Emirates and Kuwait and others, and the other countries can pitch in as well. I don't know how easy it would be, but I think it's possible to get some line of communication on this with Russia. Russia cares a great deal about radical terrorist groups such as ISIS, and they've had the problems in Chechnya and so forth in their own country, and they may be of some help. They obviously are supporting the Assad regime in Syria, I think primarily because they want that port on the Mediterranean. But the Russians, while we disagree with what the Russians are doing in eastern Ukraine, it may be, you have to sometimes look at where you can get people to be in agreement with you, at least on that, and so open up a line of communication with Russia on that issue, while letting them know we don't want them trespassing on eastern Ukraine. The way I look at Crimea is another matter. The Crimean people, if they had a plebiscite, would vote to be part of Russia. Anyway, they were just given to Ukraine right. In the days of Khrushchev, when it didn't matter what dictatorship or authoritarian you are under. But the Crimean's history is more with Russia. Anyway, eastern Ukraine's another matter.
So re-entering with the boots in Iraq is not a good option in your opinion?
No, I don't think the American people would support it. There hasn't been a case made why we need to do that. The American people will support use of drones and airstrikes. They'll support, I believe they'll support certainly arming the Kurds to fight for their own autonomy and their own security. The Iraqis, the difficulty with the Iraqi army is if the Iraqi army is not going to stand up and fight, sure, we could win a battle, which we have done before, for example, in Fallujah.
So basically, your views are much more aligned with the current policy of the administration.
I'm not sure what the current administration's policies are. They change.
They don't want to put on boots on the ground.
Right. I agree with that.
They want to have limited air strikes. You know,
right.
What you said. You know, maybe through the drones, not exactly. You know, manned.
The value of drones is they're less detectable. They cost less. And they gather intelligence and information for you, whether they're armed or not. I think the future of warfare is unmanned aerial, unmanned underwater, unmanned ground vehicles are going to be the part of the future, as well as modeling and simulation. Cybersecurity is going to be part of the future as far as military action, and less of gigantic tanks and so forth. Aircraft carriers will still be important because you need to project your power. You may not have a airfield, and that's your moving airfield to get into areas of concern. Submarines are going to be more important. They're stealthy. So the point is, I think the administration is correct in saying that we don't want to put boots on the ground. It's because we've seen boots on the ground. If the Iraqi army is not going to fight, great. You win a battle, you leave, and then they don't defend it. The Kurds will fight. And so I think being there with advisors and armaments for the Kurds makes a great deal of sense, and we ought to be using our air superiority, our unmanned aerial vehicles, our drones, armed or for intel, to the extent we can get intelligence, which is hard, about this ISIS group. I don't know where we'd get it. I doubt if we have too many infiltrators into that group that could survive. You'd have to find somebody who would defect, so to speak. But that's, that does, maybe they can find them, but it's hard. So all we know is we can arm those who want to fight. To the extent we find targets we can hit in their command and control, we ought to do so. And we ought not just do it alone. I think the French seem to be supportive of us, and I think other Arab Muslim nations are also supportive.
Governor, now
we're because the one thing that gets some of these folks united, they have all these factions fighting against one another. The one thing that will unite them is their dislike, let's say, of the United States and Israel. So that's, we don't want to allow this to turn into looking like some sort of religious war. And that's why I think other more moderate, rational-led countries in the Middle East need to be part of this effort, not just the United States or France or the U.S. and Europe.
Over to the FPAC region. Afghanistan and Pakistan. Afghanistan is still going through this presidential election process, and they haven't finalized it yet. What do you think is going on? And you know, after Karzai's tenure is over, how closely the United States should remain involved in that region? And because there are lots of concerns right now in Pakistan as well as in Afghanistan that U.S. is just going to pull out and leave them alone.
We ought to learn from the previous excursions back in the, I guess it was the 90s, yes, with Afghanistan. Both these gentlemen, they're going to have to sort it out in Afghanistan as to their election results. And hopefully they can come up with some sort of negotiated agreement. As from my perspective, both gentlemen would be good leaders. Both gentlemen said the United States, they'd want to have a United States presence in Afghanistan, which is different than the situation in Iraq where they said, no, we don't want any Americans in, or you're going to be subjected to our laws, and the Americans are not going to have our troops subjected to the incompetent governance in, let's say, Iraq. So I think we need to keep some sort of a presence. We're going to draw down, but we should keep a presence, particularly if the government wants us to have a presence. And both gentlemen in their campaign said, no, we want a status of forces agreement with it. Karzai would not agree to one of those, but both of them, as I understand it, are amenable to it. And I think it's important that I don't think we need to have as many people, but again, I think drones can be useful. And I do think having, to the extent it's safe, a presence.
And even to fly the drones, you need to have
some bases there.
In Pakistan and Afghanistan.
So. Well, Pakistan. Then you get to Pakistan, and the Pakistan issue is they're on the front lines. I mean, there's Pakistani citizens every day, I shouldn't say every day, but probably every week.
Yes.
There's some sort of terrorist attack on innocent civilians or the Pakistani military. Pakistan, obviously, is a very important country in the war on terror, since they're fighting it within their own country. Their nuclear country, and Pakistan, I think, will continue to be a very important, pivotal country. And obviously, they have all the domestic problems
exactly.
that they have in Pakistan.
It's going through another, you know, major turmoil and upheaval.
The thing on Pakistan, that both Afghanistan and Pakistan have this is typical if you have a nation of any size at all. You have a lot of different ethnicities, different tribes, different religions, backgrounds. Afghanistan is really, I mean, it's divided by a massive mountain range, all sorts of tribes, some from on the north side, some on the southern side. And it is a country that generally hasn't had a central government. It's more regional. And the only time they ever get together is when there's an invader, like the Soviet Union. That unites them. Pakistan. The concern with Pakistan is beyond the fact that Pakistan's on the front line in the war on these radical Islamic terrorists, or they use Islam as their justification. Beyond that, they have, even within their country, somewhat secessionist movements, and those are fomented by outside forces with it. So Pakistan, which has so much potential, has, and the governance, and you're originally from Pakistan, so you've followed it. And there's many Pakistani Americans who have family back home, and you just ask them how they're doing and so forth. And it's just an unfortunately very dangerous situation. But in my view, Pakistan cannot go off the radar for the United States. It's a really important country for us to stay engaged in.
Before I ask my final question about your political future, one more question about Pakistan. As we discussed, Pakistan is going through a major upheaval. The civilian government is basically embattled. So there are calls for military intervention or probably a heightened role of the military in the national affairs. How do you see the United States looking at the situation? Would there be any sympathies towards that option?
Oh goodness!
I'm not trying to put words into
I don't want
mouth,
to get it worse about it. Yeah. I thought General Musharraf, as far as I was concerned, was a friend, and I thought he was an outstanding leader. Made the right decision after 9/11. You can't imagine Americans saying you want military rule. Our tradition is one of civilian control over the military, recognizing that in some countries, such as Pakistan and Egypt, for that matter, and others, the military is much more predominant. Ultimately, what needs to be done is security and confidence in the integrity of the government in Pakistan. They do, by the way, have some energy resources there in Pakistan, which I think could be beneficial to the prosperity of the country. But you can't expect an American to say we'd like a military takeover. The military is essential in that country because they are embattled, literally embattled, not just politically, but they're under siege, particularly from the north and to some extent with the concerns in the southern part. But they obviously the tension with India as well. So they need a strong military. But what we would hope for is that you have credible, honest civilian rule is what we should strive for or aspire to for the people of Pakistan with a strong military. And I do think the relations and training between the U.S. and Pakistani military is very important. The Pakistani military leaders who've trained with the U.S. are completely different, or I shouldn't say completely different. They're more understanding of the United States. And I think that the joint operations work much easier that way, if we understand each other. And as far as the military professionals, to the extent the U.S. can continue that joint training with Pakistani military, I think that's really important, diplomatically as well as effective security.
So looking at the crystal ball, what's this going to be like in 2016 or afterwards for you?
For me?
When it comes to politics. Are you running for public office
No,
again?
No, I'm not planning on running for office. I'm doing things as I can in the private sector, working with the Manufacturers Association, as well as an association for passive optical lands. It's a technology that saves energy and it's more efficient. So I'm doing things in the private sector, helping out people who I have confidence in, who have the right ideas. In fact, unless somebody is running to want to do something, I don't care to help them out. I want to see people who are putting forward positive, constructive ideas, trying to motivate and inspire people for something rather than people who are just against everything. It's fine to be against bad ideas. I think it's more important to say what you're for and what you would do and have the credibility to believe that you'll keep your promises.
Governor, thank you very much for your interview, sir.
It's my pleasure. Absolutely.